Good evening, everybody. Thank you for such a kind and elaborate introduction, sir. This place is also new to me, and you all are new to me, but I will tell you one thing. I'm going to take this opportunity to make sure that I'm closer to you. And I'm so happy that I could come out here and meet you. And in between, when I was sitting here, I could see some familiar faces coming in, like Dr. Madhavana. So I was so happy. So I'm sure that next time when I come, I'll have more and more familiar faces and smiling faces at me. So once more, thanking you. Let us start with the discussion. So my talk is to take you through two treatment modalities. One is endarterectomy and the other one is keratoconus stenting. When we say versus, we always think that it's a fight between the two. It was always, all these years, from 1970s, it had been like that. It was a fight between the two treatment modalities for one keratoconus artery. But now, from 2015 onwards, now we know both these treatment modalities are complementary. And they are now fighting. I will tell you why. As the time goes, I think we are going to explore the reasons why it has become complementary. So, we know that after keratoconus artery, the risk of a second stroke comes down. This has been there since 1980s. Through a series of studies, we have come into that. Stenting has emerged as an alternative to endarterectomy. And this was going on with a series of studies in early 2000s. And till 2015, till the famous trial, two trials, consecutive trials came in, it was always like the stenting was chasing the endarterectomy as a treatment modality. So always we used to say, there's a keratoconus stenosis, go for endarterectomy. If it's not feasible, go for stenting. But now, it is not like that. Okay, you can offer both. But if there are some technical reasons that you cannot do stenting, you can go for endarterectomy. Or if there are some technical reasons you cannot do endarterectomy, you can go for stenting. So, comparing stenting with endarterectomy for symptomatic keratoconus stenosis, stenting was associated with a high risk of procedure-related stroke, particularly in the early patients. This was the reason why the stenting was standing behind the endarterectomy. But with the lower risk of myocardial infarction, cardiomyopathy, and site hematoma. These are the three reasons where the endarterectomy was not considered in some of the cases. The ICSS trial, this is what I was trying to say, this which came out in 2016 has changed the outlook into it. We were always thinking that after stenting, there's a possibility of recurrent strokes. There's a possibility of perioperative strokes. That is why we were not very much favoring stenting. We were going for endarterectomies. Now, this trial has proven beyond doubt that there is no statistically significant change in the number of stroke in the perioperative as well as postoperative period, and you can favor in your end. As in, for example, if I do stenting, and I can do stenting, if I can do endarterectomy. But of course, there are some technical reasons for coming. The best candidates for keratoconus endarterectomy are individuals with symptomatic significant keratoconus artery stenosis, 50% or greater. So what we do when a patient comes with a recurrent stroke, we ask for keratoconus Doppler, am I right? We all do that. When a patient comes with a stroke, we always think that, okay, maybe an artery got embolization, we always have to check the keratoconus artery. We check and found that there's a plaque. Now we want to know whether it is significant or not. If it is more than 50% stenosis, then the patient had a stroke. Significant, need to be tackled. If it is more than 60% stenosis, the patient didn't have a stroke also, it is significant, it needs to be tackled. What I'm trying to say is that two numbers come to our mind now, 50%, 60%. 50% if the patient is symptomatic, 60% if the patient is non-symptomatic even. So symptoms include, see what can be the symptoms like, when can we do it? For example, a patient comes with a stroke, an acute stroke, do we do it immediately? Not. We can do it immediately if the stroke, the infarct is less than 2 centimeters. Okay, the chance of hyperperfusion hemorrhage is lesser. But if we do, in a patient who will come with a stroke and the infarct size is too big, and if we open up immediately, there's a possibility of hyperperfusion hemorrhage. Suddenly, open circle, that doesn't it? And most of these patients will be hypertensive. On and off the patient's BP can wag and produce a hemorrhage. So we don't want that. So what do? An infarct more than 2 centimeters in size in an MRI, we go for after 6 weeks, revascularization. Otherwise, immediately we can do it. So this is what I'm trying to say, this sort of impasse which we see in the market, 50% of the spin-offs. So what we do in that Carolina, we have a workup, we do a routine series of investigations like cardiac workup. Always often, I get a call from the government doctor saying that, shall we continue the antiplatelets or not? Because we are going to go ahead with the surgery. That's one of the common questions which people ask. Yes, we need to continue. What we are worried about is, perioperative stroke, as I told you earlier. What we are only doing in the carotid, there's a possibility of perioperative stroke. To prevent that, the patient has to be on antiplatelets. Don't stop the antiplatelets. Because most of the surgeries, what we do, we have to stop the antiplatelets, wait for 7 days, then refer for the surgery. Am I right? But here, in endarterectomy, we don't stop antiplatelets. Please continue antiplatelets. Continue statins as well. Of course, we have to put in an RTD line, center line, BP has to be controlled, then knock on the CCS preferable GA. Okay. Yes. So what we have to do is a carotid exposure. How the surgery goes is like, the business to be, carotids have to be exposed. How to expose? Through an anterior border of the stomach protomastoid, we have to put in an incision. How that is, common carotid artery, inner carotid artery, stomach carotid artery. That's where we have to reach. Right? So what we see immediately is that we cut open the fascia, cut open the investing layer, we see the fat, open up, we see the carotid sheath. Yes, we all know the anatomy very well now. Once we open the carotid sheath, we are going to see the CCA bifurcation. So what's going to stop us there? This is the hypoglossal nerve. As we dissect the internal jugular vein laterally, we are going to see the carotid sheath, and inside we will have the hypoglossal nerve, right? Yes. At the same time, when we put the retractor, we should not retract too much that the recurrent laryngeal nerve gets stretched. So two nerves comes into our mind, hypoglossal nerve and the recurrent laryngeal nerve. This is the problem that we face in endarterectomy. After the surgery, patient may have difficulty in swallowing, and the voice may get disturbed. We say lower recurrent nerves are involved. Right? That's one of the complications. So now, this is the way we expose the common carotid artery and the internal carotid artery. We have to put in a shunt. Why we do that? Most of these patients might have had already an occlusion of the opposite carotid. And this will be the only carotid which is there. And we have to stop the circulation for some time through this carotid as well to do the endarterectomy. So first we have to shunt it across. We have shunt across. Then we dissect the thrombus. So that the perfusion to the brain is maintained. Right? So this is the way we do it. And after the surgery, after the removal of the, after this removal of the thrombus, then we can suture it. Once we suture some time, the artery may not be big enough, so we use a Dacron graft to close it. It's not a must that we have to use a Dacron graft. I'm sorry. Sometimes we don't have to.
Just click it. Click on the
video.
This is one of the carotid endarterectomy, you can see.
If I cross it 20 minutes, please let me know, I will stop it then.
Thank you.
So here it is. You can see here, this is the common carotid. We are going to open here the internal carotid. You can see the port scissors. We are opening here. And then we are going to get into whatever. Once we open the internal carotid, you will see the thrombus. So, yes. You can see the incision, the pulses, operator. This is the dissector which we use to dissect out the thrombus. This is the way the thrombus has to come out. The proximal end as well as the distal, you can see, it has to be intact. When I say intact, it makes a lot of sense. Because if it's not intact, you are going to leave an intimal plaque there. And postoperatively, you can have, you can see that intactness of the adhesion. It's very important for us.
Because if you leave behind a little bit of intima, as we close it and the blood starts rushing, it will get raised up and it can dissect and then can completely block the artery. So that is one of the reasons that we have to be very, very careful. What can happen then? We can have a thrombosed artery, we can have a leak from the site and then produce a hematoma. Here there's a problem with this hematoma because it's very close to the trachea, you see, and it can block the trachea and can be very, very dangerous. That's one of the complications. What are the other complications? Hypotension. As we are very close to the carotid sinus, am I right? Yes. So we can have hypotension. We have to use IV labetalol. Yes, in our eyes, we are using labetalol IV, right? Intravenous, yes. Otherwise, if it is hypotension, 99% of them is due to the diet. So atrophy, yes? So this is, of course, this is what we have to understand. If the patient doesn't have a flow through the carotid, if the patient is having a weakness, developing a weakness, immediately CTCT angio, find out if it is blocked, immediately we explore. That's it. Patient will be fine. But if you delay it over a period of time, thinking that the patient will improve after some time, it's not going to happen. Immediately explore. That's it. Attend the complication immediately. Now coming to stenting. There are clear indications for stenting. Isolated carotid artery. When I say isolated carotid artery means the other carotid is not functional. Right? This is the only carotid which is functioning, and that is the one which we have to stent. When we do an endarterectomy, there is a possibility of reduced circulation. Yes, that's why the stenting is better in such cases. High carotid bifurcation. High carotid bifurcation means the bifurcation will be behind the mandible. You see? Usually we expect the bifurcation at C4, 5 level. High means it can be behind the mandible. To explore that area and find a good place to have your shunt tube as well, it is very difficult. So that's one indication for stenting. Palate occlusions. Palate occlusion means there are two occlusions. That is, this is the aortic arch. I hope you are familiar with this anatomy, right? This is the aortic arch. You can see here the antenominate. There is this thrombus here, and there is a thrombus in the carotid. You have got a tandem occlusion. It is difficult to operate both the places, right? So we often opt for stenting. Recurrent stenosis, this is the stenting from the aortic arch here. In this case, we have to do both the places. As I told you, there is a stent which is placed here, and there is a stent which is placed here. So a 5-French wall stent was used. Low carotid bifurcation as well is a problem. The low can be as low as behind the clavicle, right? So that also can be a problem here. You can see the low carotid bifurcation here. Usually we are expecting 2, 3, 4, 5. Here we are expecting the bifurcation, but you see the bifurcation? It is very low. So it can also be difficult to operate. So we work for stenting. Yes. So band occlusions, high, low, radiolytic stenosis, stenosis after the leg dissection, and comorbid conditions for cardiac disease. What we are talking about cardiac disease, we may always think that after the stenting, it may produce bradycardia. So cardiac disease is a contraindication for stenting. Actually not. More complications of MI was separated it happens after endarterectomy than stenting. The series of studies have proven beyond doubt that if a pre-existing cardiac disease is there, it's better to go for stenting than endarterectomy. So, what do we do in stenting? An incremental approach. You know the femoral artery, right? The femoral artery is here. I am sure that you all are familiar with it, the inguinal canal, the inguinal ligament. We puncture here. Through the Schlesinger technique, we have to pass in a sheath, then we have to go with the long sheath. Once the long sheath is there, we have to be familiar with this anatomy. You can see the arch. We have to take this long sheath through the innominate into the common carotid. And we have to place there. And then, what are we expecting? There can be some complications here. We have to understand that and expect that so that we can avoid it. One is that when you are manipulating more on the arch, there can be some thrombus sitting in the arch. It can be dislodged and can embolize. So we have to emphasize the patient properly in such a way that the NCT is more than 280. So we have to make sure the patient is atomized and the manipulation has to be minimal. We always say, don't manipulate more than 20 minutes. If 20 minutes you can get it, you get it. If not, get out, do a endarterectomy. That's better. So don't try to keep on fiddling with it because you have not spoiled the patient yet. You have a second chance. If you spoil the patient, you don't have a second chance. You're finished. And the patient. So your arch anatomy is important and the toxicity also is important. So these are the two things which we have to be familiar with how to tackle. So aortic arch is the Achilles heel for carotid artery stenting. Why I'm saying this? There can be these three types of aortic arch. So it can be A, type A, type B, type C. You can find the difference here. If you see the slope, you can see the arch. See, it is coming down, it is very difficult to cannulate like this and go up. So that is the difficulty when it comes to grade 3, type 3 aortic arch. So here you see, this happens because of age and hypertension. So if the patient is prolonged, hypertensive and not managed, they may tell you, oh, patient was on the ayurvedic medication, so start with them, so then they found that the BP is normal and this is not taken for the last 3 years, any antihypertensive drugs, and you find that the patient is hypertensive, you expect this there. This patient will be having a type 3 arch and you will have difficulty in entering it. You see? So what I'm saying is, these are complementary. And if you find it difficult to stand, don't try to manipulate and spoil. Go for endarterectomy. So here, redundant common carotid. This is again a difficult thing to cannulate. So you can see here, this is a Bowen arch. Can you see this arch? This is the arch of aorta. This is the innominate. You can see the left common carotid originating from the innominate. It should originate from the arch. Right? So when it originates like this, it is difficult to go like this and take a turn. So these are the difficulties. So when we stand, we have to have a placement of our guiding head inside the common carotid, we should have a distal protection, we should have the stent placement. This is the triad. So once we place the sheath, we have to go with the protection device. The studies have proven beyond doubt, when we use a protection device, no stroke happens, or very less amount of stroke happens. So these are the protection devices. These are like umbrella, which are kept. I'm going to finish very fast. This is one of the umbrella which commonly we use. And now, this is the long sheath which we are placing for stenting this stenosis carotid ICA. So, use good judgment. It's too difficult sandwiching surgery. A technical failure is acceptable. Technical failure, the complication is not. Always watch your time, not more than 20 minutes. And my talk is also 20 minutes, right? So here, so these are the types of arches, as I told you earlier. So this can be straight, or this can be sloppy, and it can be extremely sloppy as well. So this is extremely sloppy. You can see, when it comes to the type 3, it can be extremely sloppy. So it is difficult to cannulate them. More trouble when it is stomach toxicity is present. So what the stents we use? Here you can see the closed cell stent. Here we can see the open cell stent. Usually we prefer the closed cell when there's a thrombus, because when we put the stent, we don't want the thrombus to embolize. But if it's an open, it can embolize, because the cells are open, it gives way and thrombus can get into an embolization. So what we do, in a tortuous vessel, which is very curvy, we might have to use a stent which is having open cells. But otherwise, always prefer for a closed cell stent. This is the open cell design. This is the problem with the open cell. You can see that they're not supporting everywhere. You see? So always we prefer to use a closed cell stent. So lesion diagnosis is also we have to watch. Out of this length of lesion, not a problem. Personal stenosis, not a problem. Percussion of the lesion, not a problem. Ulceration, not a problem. You can stent. Calcification, if there's calcification, you have to be watchful. While breaking it, can embolize. So that is one thing which we have to be careful about. The length of the lesion, you can see this is long, this is short, no problem. You can see here the calcification. Can you see the calcification? It's a problem. You understand, tone is small, yes. So here you see the calcification, more chance for stroke, preoperative stroke. Aortic arch is a risk factor. Plan beforehand, investigate properly. If stenting is too risky, you should go to a vascular surgeon. A technical failure with no complication is acceptable. Potential complications. Dissection can happen, spasm can happen, stroke, inguinal hematoma, least stenosis, hypoperfusion, hemorrhage can happen. This is one case, you can see the stenosis, post-stending, you can see the stenosis, post-stending, you can see the stenosis, you can see this is after balloon angioplasty, this is a stent which is kept here, and you can see the stenotic ostium, you can see after the balloon angioplasty, this is after the stenting. This again, you can see here, this patient came to me around a year back. I told them at that time itself, better to go for stenting. Then they told me, okay, fine, but the son had to go to US. Then he had to come back by the time the second shot. So after second shot, I told them, better to go now. By the time what happened, you see this? Usually, intercarotid comes here, there'll be three branches. The other branches are not filling. He had two straws and blocked both the branches. Only one branch is working by now. Of course, we stented it then. So, treatment of carotid is indicated in patients with symptomatic stenosis more than 50%, asymptomatic stenosis more than 60%. The CREST study has proven beyond doubt, both are equal. You can go either of that, no issues. Thank you very much for your patient visit. Yeah, CT or MRI, we can calculate the, we can measure the infarct size. So now, when it comes to the size of the infarct, what we are worried about is hyperperfusion hemorrhage. It is found that if it is more than 2 cm infarct, if you stent immediately, that's a possibility of hyperperfusion hemorrhage. So what we do is, if the infarct size is more than 2 cm, we tell them, we put on double antiplatelets, we tell them come after 6 weeks, we'll stent after 6 weeks. If, for example, the infarct size is less than 2 cm, we can immediately do it. Immediately do the stenting.
I want to know
which area is not an issue. Any area is the same. Whether it is subcortical, the cortical, the hemispheric, posterior fossa, no difference. Criteria is the same. Any other questions you can mail me as well. Thank you. I'll answer your mails.
the stent thing, sir?
Yeah, it will come through. The cost of the stent, most of the stents comes to around 80,000. So you have to use a production device as well. It also costs around 80,000 rupees. So stent plus the production device, the umbrella which we gave, it comes to around 1.6. So plus the procedure, it will come to around 2.2, 2.3 lakhs. Working. Okay.